Hi, welcome to Popcorn Time, where we take a look at the box office hits and the latest news on Hollywood's biggest stars. I'm Adrian Virgilio.
And I'm Andrew Paniagua. Let's get into this week's top five at the box office. Still in the top five this week is Sully, the story of the miraculous plane landing on the Hudson by Captain Chesley Sullenberger. The film has received an 82% review on Rotten Tomatoes and an average user rating of 4 out of 5 stars. So far, it has grossed a total of $153 million and continues to increase as the weeks go on. Let's check out this short clip from Sully.
Mayday, mayday, mayday. This is Cactus 1549. Hit birds. We've lost thrust on both engines. We are turning back towards the LaGuardia.
Which engine did you lose?
Both engines.
Ignition. Thrust levers confirm. Idle.
Idle.
Cactus 1549, if we can get a few, do you want to try to land runway 13?
This is the captain. Brace for impact.
I feel like Tom Hanks is perfect for the role. I don't think there's a better actor out there to capture the suspense like he did.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he did a similar movie a few years back. It was also based off a recent event as Captain Phillips, I believe it was, which was, it turned out great. I'm sure the director saw that and they were like, oh, let's pick him up for this movie.
Number four at the box office, grossing at $13.48 million this weekend, is Storks. This animated flick is about a young boy with very busy parents who is lonely and looking for a younger sibling to have as a playmate. Turning to storks to help him and his parents in getting them a baby, the boy soon finds out that the storks are no longer in the baby delivery business. Instead, they deliver packages for an online retailer. Finding a baby in inventory at the retailer's warehouse, the storks are forced to deliver one last bundle of joy to his family. Let's take a look at the trailer for Storks.
I love you, brother. It's like we're best friends that live together.
I'm positive about
Mom, Dad, I've decided I want a baby brother.
Dear Stork Delivery Service,
our son really deserves a baby brother. P.S.
He has to have ninja skills.
Junior, I saved this company by getting out of babies and into package delivery. Monday, it'll all be yours. Barring any monumental screw-up.
Tulip?
Whoa!
What is that?
Cool beans.
Storks don't deliver babies anymore. If anyone finds out about this, I am dead meat.
Baby powder.
Homing pigeon powers activate.
Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, here we go.
Ah.
Was it the baby?
No. Just a brief exposure to baby cuteness can ruin your life.
Storks. This film is not yet rated.
This looks like a great film to bring your family out to.
Absolutely. Take your kids, grandkids, girlfriends, boyfriends. This movie is great for all ages.
Definitely. Next, coming in at number three this week, grossing $15.63 million, is The Magnificent Seven. This remake of the 1960 film, The Seven Samurai, tells the tale of seven bandits who gang up to protect their town from a mining capitalist and his rash crew who plan to take over residents' private property by force. The seven-man army is led by a bounty hunter and also includes a gambler, a troubled ex-soldier, a mountain man, an expert knife thrower, an outlaw, and a Comanche warrior. Here's a clip from The Magnificent Seven.
Took a job looking for some men to join me. Is it difficult? Impossible. I'm in.
Oh, we're good. We got a Mexican.
Oh, I sense we are bonding.
A man has taken over our town.
These people deserve their lives back.
We got seven.
He's got an army.
Worst case scenario, we all die.
You gotta hate what you're firing at!
Take a shot.
The Magnificent Seven in IMAX.
Wow, the amount of stars they have in this film is crazy. You can't really go wrong with big stars like Denzel Washington, Chris Pratt, and Ethan Hawke.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I'm not even that into Westerns, but with a cast like that, I probably am going to check this one out.
Moving on to number two with a weekend gross of $20.22 million is Deepwater Horizon. It's a story about the 2010 oil rig explosion in the Gulf of Mexico, where 130 million gallons of oil was spewed into the waters, making it the worst offshore oil spill in the history of the United States. The film tells the story of the 11 crew members on board the rig and the challenges they were faced with as they fought for survival. Here's Deepwater Horizon.
Critics are calling Deepwater Horizon masterful.
But my husband, Mike Williams, is on the Deepwater Horizon.
It's stunning and exhilarating. Mark Wahlberg is excellent.
Trust me, you're not gonna die.
Come on!
Deepwater Horizon will make you believe in the power of the human spirit. It's a must-see.
Thank you.
Deepwater Horizon, rated PG-13, in theaters and IMAX September 30th.
Another movie based off of a real-life tragic event seems to be a popular theme these days in Hollywood.
Yeah, I'd say it's a good thing you get to teach people about real-life events and bring up issues they may not know about.
Oh, I agree. I mean, I guess it's also a good thing for the families of the 11 crew members who passed away. They'll have their loved ones' names sort of like memorialized in the film.
Absolutely.
Finally, coming in at number one this week at the box office with a weekend gross of $28.8 million is Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, which is an adaptation of Ransom Riggs' novel. A boy named Jake follows clues left by his grandfather that leads him to a magical world known as Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. He becomes familiar with the residents and gets to know their peculiar powers. Danger is among them, and Jake soon realizes that the only way he can save his new friends is with his own special powers. Let's take a look at Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children.
If this is how you're feeling, it's time to be peculiar.
He's invisible.
Of course.
On September 30th.
This isn't even the fun part. Do you want to see the fun part?
Tim Burton invites you.
My main skill is the manipulation of time.
To discover your power.
Let's see what you can do.
Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, rated PG-13, September 30th.
I saw this in IMAX, and all the effects and cinematography was incredible. I think everyone should go see this film.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I'd expect no less from a director like Tim Burton. He's always known for his weird and quirky style of filming, and his movies are really phenomenal and fun to watch.
Great. Well, that wraps up this week's five top box office hits. Andrew, do you like horror films?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's scary moments, there's gore, suspense. What's not to love about it?
I agree. That's why in this week's classic movie segment, our very own Haley Vasiliev will be covering an iconic horror film that's been terrifying viewers for decades.
With October 31st just a few short weeks away, what a better way to get into the Halloween spirit than with a classic horror movie that's sure to keep you up at night. The original 1978 Halloween film is the story of Michael Myers, who has been sentenced to 15 years in prison for stabbing his sister when he was only 6 years old. While in prison, Myers escapes, where he returns to his hometown of Haddonfield, Illinois. Once back in Haddonfield, Myers begins to stalk teenager Laurie Strode, played by Jamie Lee Curtis, constantly appearing and vanishing around Laurie throughout the film. For the most part, Strode is able to escape from Myers unharmed. When Halloween debuted, the film grossed nearly $50 million worldwide at the box office. This was a surprise hit, making it one of the most successful independent films ever made. While an explosive success, the film had a relatively low budget of $325,000 and was filmed in only a short 20 days. Halloween debuted in October of 78, but was filmed in the spring of that same year. You can see that in the scenes where the trees are visible, foliage is fully green and not autumnally colored. Director John Carpenter wanted to recolor all the trees, but budgetary restrictions made that not possible. Now, you may have noticed that the film did not have many stationary shots. The camera seemed to always be in constant motion. A large majority of the scenes were shot with a handheld Steadicam rig to add to the eeriness of the film. This trick was to make the audience feel disoriented and paranoid, that every little noise, every corner, and every shadow was potentially dangerous, and it made everyone feel like they will be a helpless victim. Be sure to check out this film to get you pumped for Halloween. And that's all for Classic Movie of the Week.
Thank you, Haley. Ever have a hard time figuring out what movie to watch on date night? Well, our very own Adriana Virgilio may be able to help you decide, as she highlights some of the best date night films in a segment we like to call Netflix and Chill.
With Halloween just around the corner, Netflix just introduced a handful of classic movies available during the beginning of October. Whether you're chilling by yourself or with bae, these movies are just right for you. Starting off with the Halloween horror film is The House is October Built. Five friends hit the road to find the best gimmicky Halloween house, but soon real evil begins to hound their steps. If you're looking for a classic comedy, we've got RV, starring the one and only Robin Williams, who plays a flustered patriarch that takes his family on a cross-country bonding trip in a motorhome. And last on our list, ladies, this one's for you. We've got a romantic comedy, How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days, starring Kate Hudson and Matthew McConaughey. A player bets his co-workers that he can make a woman fall in love with him in just 10 days. But he bets on the wrong girl, a writer with her own agenda. That's all for Netflix and Chill. Now we're going to switch back over to Andrew, where he's going to give you the latest celebrity gossip.
Unfortunately, there's a lot of sad news coming to us this week concerning some of Hollywood's biggest stars. Most recently, Angelina Jolie has filed for divorce from hubby Brad Pitt. The celebrity power couple, affectionately known as Brangelina by their fans and the media, have decided to end their two-year-long marriage. The couple have been together for just over 10 years after falling in love while working together on the set of Mr. and Mrs. Smith in 2004. Angelina cites the reason for the divorce as irreconcilable differences. She says that there's a lot of conflict between them in concerns of their kids, as well as substance abuse and general anger issues from Brad. She feels that the divorce is what's best for the safety and well-being of their children. The separation doesn't come without conflict, as Angelina is asking for the judge for sole physical custody of their six kids. The couple also has to figure out how to divvy up their combined $400 million fortune, which includes several homes in Los Angeles, New Orleans, and France. This may end up being a very long court battle, and we can only hope that Angelina and Brad can find some sort of middle ground and hopefully end their relationship on good terms for the sake of their kids. In even more shocking news, earlier this week, Ben Stiller made the shocking reveal that he has been secretly battling with prostate cancer. While speaking on the Howard Stern Show, he announced that 2 years ago, he was diagnosed with what doctors call immediately aggressive prostate cancer. 3 months after the diagnosis, he went into surgery, and doctors were able to successfully remove the tumor. Take a quick look as Ben describes how he felt about the whole ordeal.
I mean, at first, I didn't know what was going to happen. So right. I was scared. You know, I was scared. I didn't know. You know, the one thing that it does is it just stops everything in your life when you get a diagnosis of cancer, because you can't plan for a movie. You can't.
No.
You know, because you don't know what's going to happen.
Did you have to get surgery?
I did.
You did. And that's who's with you, your surgeon?
Yeah.
Should we bring him in?
Yeah, definitely.
All right. This is Dr. Ted Schaefer. You caught it early, right?
It was picked up early, and he's doing great.
Yeah.
The decision-making about what treatment you have is a complicated journey. There's a whole variety of what kind of cancer you can get, and then there's what's the age of the patient and how healthy is that patient.
You know, what kind of cancer did Ben have?
He had an intermediately aggressive cancer.
Ben was fortunate in that he learned about it early enough by getting a prostate exam. Thankfully, Ben has remained cancer-free ever since. In other news, Keeping Up with the Kardashians star Kim Kardashian was robbed last Sunday while staying in a hotel in Paris. Kim was alone in her hotel room when five masked men dressed as police officers arrived at the hotel, two of which gained access to a room and came in wielding handguns. They gagged her and tied her up while they proceeded to raid the room, stealing around $10 million worth of jewelry, including Kim's $4 million wedding ring. Kim left France on Monday after being interviewed by investigators and is currently back in New York City with her husband, Kanye West. The night of the robbery, Kim's personal bodyguard, Pascal Duvier, was sent out to be with sisters Courtney and Kendall while they were visiting a local club. Kim thought she was safe alone inside her hotel, but after this robbery, the West family has begun to take their security quite a bit more seriously. Kanye has since invested $6 million more into extra security measures, which include armored car escorts, 30 bodyguards, and even Kim Kardashian lookalikes to act as doubles in public. Paris police are still investigating the robbery, but have yet to identify any of the five suspects.
That's awful. We're all wishing Kim a speedy recovery.
Absolutely. And that's all we have for today. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Andrew Paniagua.
And I'm Adriana Virgilio. Don't forget to come back in 2 weeks for our next episode of Popcorn Time.
Bye.
Bye.